the other, I'm not geared for the other way. I cannot say to somebody, you've got it, when they don't have it. I'm not geared that way. Because you're doing an enormous disservice to everybody, actually. Enormous disservice. But you can't stop people from doing that either. You really can't stop. They can come to see you for a while and then they say, okay, I'm entitled, that's enough. I know I'm entitled to say I'm enlightened, I put the time in. How can you stop them from doing that? You see what I'm saying? A lot of the teachers, they say, I never told anyone to teach. I never said anyone's a guru or never told anyone to teach. Punjaji said that. A lot of people said they were enlightened from Punjaji. And he said, I never said anyone was enlightened. I never said, why'd you send them away? To bring people back to Lucknow, he said, to tell them about Lucknow and to come to see him. But they instead they set up shop and said they'd come to see them. Hey, well, why did you say to give them all these experiences? To get the leeches off my back. Get the leeches off my back. They were just... But look what happened. So you really can't... Now, Sri Nandamayama insisted she wasn't anyone's guru. No, nobody's guru. So if she's no one's guru, how could she bestow, say that someone else is a guru? Never did. Never said anybody was really a guru. Not really. She said some her husband, their mother, had some status of helping others, but she never said that somebody is a teacher. You don't see anyone saying that Anandamayi Ma said that they're a teacher, a guru or something. No. So you have to actually abide in the light yourself. In the real tradition. You cannot point to some other teacher and say, well, that teacher sent me out to teach. You cannot do that. You have to see the vision of oneness yourself. Literally see it and abide in it, accept it, and then, you know what it's all about. You know what it's all about. Now, there may be some genuine teachers that went to see other two. Okay, there's some. But I'm telling you the overall game that's being played here in the world. Of course, we have to speak in generalities, otherwise we can't speak at all, right? This is another trick the ego uses. You can't speak in generalities. And I should say to people, you cannot speak in non-generalities. Who are you to speak in non-generalities? Who are you to demand non-generalities, right? Because then you can't say anything. It's a way of shutting you up. Say, don't generalize. It's a way of shutting you up. Of course, they'll go on then to generalize about everybody from their entitlement standpoint. So they want to be able to say who can speak and who cannot speak, really. It's always that way in this world. It's just that it's all in flux, and there's a new group has taken over now. And of course, they think that they are now the new entitlement class, which they don't realize exactly at this point, is another class that's going to displace them, which is the ETs, actually, the hybrids. There's been a hybridization program that's taking place underground here on this planet, in underground, large underground facilities, and maybe some on some extraterrestrial places. They just really said, oh, by the way, there's these oceans in the ring of moons of Saturn or rings of Saturn or something, that maybe the moons. There's a ton of water on Saturn, ton of water under the ice, huge amount of ice, vast oceans. Hey, how about that? Say there probably is life. They think there's organic compounds in the water and stuff. There's probably life on Saturn. Hey, how about that? Of course. That's one of the hangouts, Saturn, for extraterrestrials. One of the hangouts, Saturn. That's what they call it, Satan, Saturn. Satan, the ETs come from Saturn, but that's that's just a localized way station, Saturn. And so they will displace the entitlement class that has arisen right now, because they are not enlightened, you see, and it's easy to displace them, very easy. So uneasy lies in uneasy is the head upon which lies the crown, right? Very uneasy in terms of entitlement. But when you see the vision of oneness, that's a genuine crown, and there's no uneasiness there at all. That's the genuine crown. Now, why do all these people claiming to be enlightened in this entitlement class, New World Order, all stuff? Because the ETs told them to do so. And see, the ETs, they think they have a higher entitlement. They have higher entitlement. The ETs are very entitlement-oriented. And, of course, they're preaching equalitarianism, of course they are, but they're the only ones that are allowed to preach it, and they're disciples, right? They're the Politburo, spiritual Politburo. And they said, you know, do this, you know, we're putting, you're entitled to do this. But what they didn't get was, the ETs see them as easy to replace once they come here, but they'll easily flip-flop and then see that the ETs are higher entitlement than them, and will fit right into the spiritual hierarchy of it, and they'll say, oh, of course, we'll do whatever you have to say because you have higher entitlement than we do. Easy, you see, and they don't have all the guns and stuff, right? So it's all a, this is how it is, this is the game. This is the game. But what you want is genuine entitlement, which the vision of oneness places upon you like a crown. When you're crowned by the vision of oneness, that's a legitimate situation. But then how do you teach in a world that is actually geared towards giving all entitlements to the extraterrestrials? Quote-unquote, spiritual masters, quote-unquote, quote-unquote. Now, the spiritual masters and all this kind of stuff, again, this is part of the fantasy fairy tale that we have, but it's a necessary fairy tale, temporarily, because of the continuity fear. So I'm not like some iconoclastic person who is trying to tear anything down. No. I'm simply pointing out what the game is, but it's a game that has to be played because of the continuity fear. It's so severe that people cannot go directly to truth and say, junk all this, it's all nonsense. They can't do it. So there is this kind of legit, what do you call it, semi-legitimacy to it all. From a certain perspective, there's this temporary legitimacy to it, a certain pragmaticism to it, a certain matter of pragmaticism to it. So in order to usher in a new age, you know, it's like a child. You know, when you usher in a new age, it's like the birth of a new child. Who is best at birthing children? Women are, okay? So that is why women have been put in power, in charge. They're the new entitlement class. Certain types of women, certain types that are ushering in this new age of giving birth to it. And of course, they're claiming that they're enlightened, that they have all the status. They say that they're entitled to be seen this way. So it's the Empress that's in charge at the time. And the Empress has no clothes, but you can't say that. So they're giving birth to this new age, but the baby will be handed over to the extraterrestrials, because they're the ones who really planned this whole thing, the so-called spiritual masters, who, by Joakul's own statements, are extraterrestrials. The main lodge is on Sirius, and they're spread throughout the galaxy, and many different dwelling places throughout the galaxy, and they're, you know, working with this world to give birth to this new age. And then once the new age is birthed, then the spiritual masters will come here into the world and work with people, you know, more directly and all this kind of stuff. Well, you know, that may very well happen. It may very well happen from a pragmatic standpoint, but none of this is real. It's all a projection. It's all an illusion. It's all a fairy tale, actually. It's simply a story we're telling ourselves because we out of dread of the abyss, we need to feel that that the abyss is somewhere is in the far future, and we're okay here as we work on this thing. It's a kind of therapy, you know. It's a kind of therapy. But once you see through it all, you know, you're not really interested in it. I don't know how these spiritual masters can. To me, they're psychic projections. They're part of our mind's projections. They are. So, they're complexes of projection. Because how could a genuine spiritual master really play that game that way? Where could the motivation come from? I just don't see it, you know. I just don't know how they could possibly function the way that they're supposedly going to function. Because they would have to know this is all just a dream. This is all just a fantasy that we're presenting. It's like, I wonder, how can the priests tell people the stuff they tell people, that death is permanent, don't worry, you're safe. I say, how could they? I couldn't possibly do that. I couldn't possibly, my conscience could not allow me to do that. So how can an enlightened master come in and tell people about all this stuff is true, you know, which is all a lie? It's a kind of a expedient, temporary expedient out of pragmatism to give people a story to follow. But I don't know how my conscience could allow that. I really don't. So I have a hard time thinking I could be part of that, you know, the New World Order and you know, the spiritual masters and all that kind of stuff. It just like nails on a chalkboard. Good Lord. But, you know, there's some level. You know, it's kind of like parents telling children, explaining stuff to children. They don't really tell them the truth because the child can't understand the truth. It may be something like that, that they reach some point of such total stability in oneness that you're able to be purely pragmatic, and the child asks you, well, how do I get bliss? And you're able to say, well, you know, you kind of need to go through all these steps and jump through all these hoops, and that's how you do it. Knowing that at some point the child's going to be reject that and say no, and then you can have some other explanation. It's theoretically it's possible. Theoretically it's possible, but it gives me the creeps. The ETs, by their own admission, are notorious liars, and almost virtually everything they tell us is a lie. And some of them, you know, admit to it. They say, yeah, we are liars, but we're lying for your own good, because you won't accept the truth. So we're lying, telling you these helpful lies. That's a slippery slope, you know. I have a hard time with that, for sure. So I'm not good with that. I'm not good with it. But I understand theoretically, you know, that there's this all this lying taking place. But you know, that's the kind of stuff I want to get distance myself from. Wow. But very few people can handle direct truth. Almost everybody wants just a better lie. You know, that's what they want. So, you know, here's the thing, if people just demanding and desiring a better lie, that manifests in our imagination. So if we say, I really want, you know, this beautiful lie that I can believe in for forever and ever and ever, it will manifest as some spiritual master with ascended angels and all this teaching and of stuff, and it will be there for you as your own projection of your prayer. It's really weird, you know. Projection is very weird like that. It is. And I said, I want a genuine teacher, and the genuine teacher showed up and said, you just gotta practice. There's no, you know, we're not with you. You know, we're not gonna hang out with you. What? Say, no, you got to hang out with us. In order to hang out with us, you got to be legitimate. I said, wow, that's tough work. How do we do that? He said, you got to work at it. I said, whew, this is really brutally difficult. So, yeah, I didn't get any ascended master coming and channeling through me and all this, you know, stuff or some teacher saying, you're enlightened. No, he said, you don't get it. You're not enlightened. You need to work harder at it. You need to really apply yourself. We're not going to come see you. Yeah, instead of saying that we're going to come see you, they said, we're not going to come see you. And then I said, well, I'll make a psychic projection and that'll come, of you, and that'll come see me. But that's what got me into trouble. We have the power to make psychic projections of these teachers and say that they're coming to see us. But the real teacher, they may very well say, we're not going to come see you. You got to come see us. See, that puts the responsibility, you know, in your court. And then you got to, and then you say, well, how do I prepare? And they say, well, the Holy Spirit will prepare you. Jesus said, I'm leaving you now because I need to. It's better for you if I go because this, you know, you can't stand the fact that I have no attraction to death at all. You can't stand it. It freaks you out. And so you're just going to spin all these, you know, idolatry around me, but I'm going to leave. But I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to you. I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit's where it's at. The Holy Spirit will educate you, so you'll eventually understand what I was teaching. He says, nobody here understands what I'm teaching. Nobody. Nobody. Peter, you know, something very vague. So he says, okay, Peter, I'll start things out with you. Apparently, that's what they say. Because he understood a little better than most, but still didn't understand. And Jesus said, you've got to be educated by the Holy Spirit so you can understand. Otherwise, you won't. You won't understand my teachings. You will not. You'll get it twisted all upside down and backwards, which has happened. Let's make the death is permanent. We're saved. Now, that's completely backwards. And so it's the Holy Spirit is what prepares us to go and see the real teachers. Because what is there then? What is it for them to say? Except you either have the vision of oneness or you don't. If you don't, you don't. It's that simple. And you can say, well, I've been working on it for 50 years. And they say, well, you don't have it, you don't have it. I don't care how long you've been working on it. But, you know, I've worked at it 18 hours a day for 50 years. And they say, well, you know, you better spend your time better then. Because you've been wasting a lot of time. If that's the case, you know, they say, yeah, I know that's the case, but you haven't got it yet. You haven't got it yet. And you know, who's ready for that, to hear that? And they say, well, I might spend another 50. And they say, well, yeah, I mean, if you don't practice the right way, you will spend another 50 and another 50 after that and more after that. So you better start, you know, doing the right practices or else you're going to, you know, still don't get it. So that's, you know, tough love. Tough love is really the best remedy. No, it doesn't seem like anybody is willing for tough love in this world. That's what I'm seeing. That's become an anathema to the world. An anathema to the world. Here, it's like everybody graduates. Doesn't matter what your talents are. Everybody graduates. Nobody left behind. No child left behind. That's discrimination. That's discrimination. How dare you discriminate? Well, how come everybody's not let into Harvard? It's necessary to have, you know... How come I can't get into Stanford then? You're discriminating against me. No. We need the right appropriate people to spread the appropriate doctrine around the world. So you know, you're not haven't been picked for that. But still, you're not entitled to make that objection. You're not entitled to it. Everyone's equal, no one's left behind. But what about, you don't have the entitlement to speak, sorry. To make inequality, so shut them up, and don't listen to them. And everyone says, oh, right, we're listening to you because you're telling us that we don't need to, you know, that we don't need to, we just need to put a little time and we'll get their diploma. You'll give us our diploma. But the real teachers know that the vision of oneness is the diploma. There is no other diploma. There is no other crown. Sooner we recognize this and accept this, the quicker we'll finish, as a matter of fact. You know, I rejected this. I resisted. And then finally I'm coming around to it and having glimpsed it. You know, it's like, wow. No kidding. They told me the truth. Jesus and Anandamayama and Longchenpa and Raman Maharshi, they spoke the truth about the situation. You know, a vision of oneness, you have to get it. You have to have it. No exceptions. None. You call it the vision of non-specialness, is what it is. And it's not an abyss. We think it's an abyss. No, it's, you're saved from the abyss. You're saved from the coma. You're saved from your imagination. You're saved from whim, is what it really is. It saves you from whim, because the belief in specialness was the belief in an abyss. And that was a whimsical desire on our part, a whimsical idea. So we're saved from the whim. We're saved from the madness of whim, and the madness of whim is terrible. It's terrible. There's no reference points within whim. Whim is an absolute dictator, an absolute maniac. It's totally insane. There's no sanity within whim. None. Whim says that truth is whatever it wants it to be. The truth is that it's mercy. And whim, if it wants this to be true, it's true. If it says this, though, lies can be true. It makes, you know, it's all whimsical. So whim is an absolute, completely insane maniac. So the vision of non-specialness saves us from whim, the abyss of whim. The only abyss there is whim. That's the only abyss there is. And, of course, it's whimsical, because there is no abyss. But whim won't tell you that, right? So the only abyss we fall into is is whimsicality. That is the abyss. And how do you get out of it, you see, is the question. Because whim will say, okay, you're out of it, you're enlightened. And then later on, say, okay, you're not enlightened, now you're in it again. And so you're not really out of it. You're not really out of it until you see the vision of oneness. You're not. But you can get into an entitlement class and get stamped that you're enlightened, and then you think you're out of it because nobody will tell you that you're not. And you think that's good enough. It's not. It's not good enough, because whim will change his mind on you. To maintain your entitlement. But whim, being in charge, will always, you know, sell you out. So the sooner we accept vision of oneness is the goal. That's it. I have no other goal. No other goal. Now, in the Course in Miracles, Jesus talks in a certain way, and it's easy to not get it, because what he says and emphasizes is you cannot make a single exception to truth. That's the core teaching. You cannot make a single exception. And concepts cannot understand that, because they're all about bringing two things together that are separate and uniting them. And the idea, you can't make a single exception, the unitary vision, you cannot conceptually understand that, really. You think, well, there must be at least one exception, and we'll unite with that exception, and then the concept, you can get the concept from that. Now, Jesus says, for instance, practice. I am in danger nowhere in this world. I am in danger nowhere in this world am I in danger. Walk this day totally free of danger. And you say, well, how in the world can I do that? That is crazy. How? Well, remember, he says nowhere. He didn't say you can walk everywhere except one place. He didn't say that. He said nowhere. Totally different. You assume he means I can walk almost everywhere in this world and not be in danger. But then you say, but how do I deal with that one place that is dangerous? You know, I don't want to walk in East so-and-so. We've got places, plenty of places in California. You don't dare walk, you know, from the conceptual standpoint. So he's not saying you can walk almost everywhere free of all danger. He's saying you can walk everywhere. Nowhere are you in danger. Nowhere are you in danger. That's the whole key to the teaching. If you don't get that, you can't either. You won't get it. You won't get it. And you'll spin it into a new world order kind of teaching, which some of the teachers of A Course in Miracles are just new world order people spinning the course into the new world order to get their entitlements. You know, that's part of what's happened. But Jesus is not saying that. He's saying nowhere. Nowhere. There's no exception to truth. Not any exception whatsoever. Not even the tiniest exception. Total non-specialness. From that standpoint, everything holds together in A Course in Miracles. It's all true. It all holds together. But how difficult is that for us to accept that premise, you know, of no exclusion, not even one? That's the whole point of the Course. It's the whole point of it. Not making a single exception. If you make a single exception, you won't get the vision of oneness. You will not. So you're nowhere. You're still going to be seeking attractive forms of death, is what you're going to be doing. You'll be attracted to the new world order of, we got some really attractive forms of death coming for you, and you'll be happy with those. So, not judging, understanding that's whoever's attracted into that, that's where they're at. Okay? That's fine. That's where they're at. But I don't want to be there. That's not where I'm at. So, I got to get, there is no exception. He says you're in danger nowhere. So, to those New World Order teachers, they'll be empowered for sure in big universities, and you know, they'll have all sorts of hierarchy and structure. There'll be religious structure, leaders of that, and the whole hierarchy to the whole thing that's coming, the New World religion. You know, you're going to have to teach that, well, there's, you know, we didn't really mean no place. We meant it's a process. It's a process. It's a process. Jesus is not talking about process. He is not talking about process at all. Now, theoretically, neither are the Neo-Advaitins, okay? The genuine ones. They're not talking about process either. This is a full stop. I just came to a full stop. That's why I just stopped here. But you cannot get into the hierarchy of the New World Order that way, you see. You cannot, if you're full stopped. Now, I know that there's some teachers, you know the popular teachers of the times, and Eckhart Tolle, and Muji, and Ganjaji, and Sailor Bob Adamson, and you know, various teachers, and what's his name, Adyashanti, and these, you know, there's lots of teachers around of all different types, and You know, maybe some of them do see the vision of oneness. But what I've noticed, like for instance, Muji, okay. I've studied Muji a lot and pay a lot of attention to Muji. To me, Muji is very disgruntled about the way, you know, with the way things are going. He's very irritated. No question about it. He is scratching his head. It's like, you know, ask me some real questions. What the heck's going on here? What's going on here? Well, what's going on is there are a ton of people who want to get into the New World Order hierarchy, who want to pay, you know, their ticket to doing it. And Muji's like saying, like, you know, guys, you know, you gotta see the vision of oneness. You know, you just can't. Getting into a hierarchy isn't where it's at. And the people who's coming to him, this Muji Muji says, you know, this is where we're at. You know, you want to help us? This is where we're at. So help us out. And I see in teachers like this frustration. There's a frustration. You say, I want to help you, but you're coming to me for some other reason, you know, and I'm trying to turn you and bend you over to the, no, it's not working. So eventually it seems like the teachers, they just kind of say, okay, okay, whatever, you know, all right. They kind of lose their potency. They kind of lose their potency is what I've seen. It's what I see. That full stopness doesn't seem as quite as potent as I would. You know, it's not Sri Anandamaya Ma, who never lost her potency, full potency all the time. She didn't care about any spiritual hierarchy. She didn't care about, well, I'm trying to get into some spiritual hierarchy. Didn't care. No spiritual ego at all. Didn't care. So the potency remained. But after a while, because nobody is really interested in that, there was this sort of, because her appearance took on what people wanted to see. And you could tell it was just going through the motions, you know, just going through the motions. If this is what you want me to do, okay, I'm your robot. But the potency was still there, apparently, from those who went to see her. They said, oh my gosh, she's just appears to be this old lady going through darshan, blessing, giving this prasad, 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 you know. But the potency was still there, totally, if that's what you wanted. This just was just a, you know, robot facade. That's what people wanted. That's what they insisted upon. And she didn't fight it. She didn't fight it. So there was no fighting it, and no frustration. I need to make it. There was none of that there. Just a rag doll. This is what you want me to be. This is what I am. But the full potency of non-specialness, one was still entirely there. But she didn't initiate anyway. She didn't fall for the game. Didn't play the game. What I'm seeing now is there's this friction. You know, there's this friction with the teachers, and because of this new world order, new world religion that's coming, that people are coming to see them because of that. To a large extent. It's like, Muji, how can I get into the, you know, the right position? Right spiritual position here with this world. How can I get the right spiritual position? If I come to see you, can you give me the right things to say? How do I function as a guru in this new world religion? When someone comes to see me, how do I deal with that? They're trying to get the form of it. And there's some people who are very adept at putting on the form of something. They're very good at form. A lot of them are women, very, very talented actresses who know how to put on the form of enlightenment. And they just want tips, acting tips, really, acting tips. They're really coming for acting tips, primarily, yeah. Because they that's what they feel they need to do to be in, you know, in well positioned in the new world order. And so Muji's like, ask me a little, come on, ask me, I want real questions here. I want real, you know, devotee. I want people who really want truth. Come on, what is this? What is this? It's like, I don't know if, you know, if that may have happened to other teachers. It may have happened to Dafri John. I don't know what happened to him, what his thing was. But it's, you know, at the end he's just like totally freaked out. Like, what happened? The devotees may have, you know, he had ended up the way they wanted him to be. You know, they wanted to be entitled to something if possible. I usually say that the devotees get the teacher they deserve because it's a psychic projection of what they want. But in the end, you look at like Dafri John, you look at that teacher, and it's like, he's got the most horrible expression on his face you've ever seen. It's like, terrifying. Absolutely terrifying. Like turning you to stone. You look at that, he's like the Hydra. You look at it, he'll turn to stone. That's how scary it is. Holy cow. I mean, that's not in my mind. No, not in my mind. Kept doing the robotic motions of blessing, but still completely benign, you know, completely blissful. No, you know, didn't get freaked out by it. But it seems as though teachers get freaked out by the students here, because the students really want to use them for their own purposes. And so you become a projection of the desires of those who come to see you, is what happens. You get turned into stone. You know, it seems like Dafri John was turned into stone. Really. It's such a scary thing. It's like petrified. Turned into a mummy. It's funny, his little opera that he wrote, or spiritual drama, is called the mummery. Well, he got turned into a mummy is what happened to him. He got turned into the head of the hierarchy. don't want that. And Sri Nanda Ma did not, because she said, I'm beyond all hierarchies. I'm truth is beyond all hierarchies. What I am is not touched by any hierarchy, any spiritual hierarchy at all. It's not touched by it, which is very true, very true. So she didn't make any pronouncements about I am the greatest guru of all time, like Dafri John did. She said, no, truth is formless. It's beyond the beyond. It's beyond the highest hierarchy, you know. It's untouched by it. Untouched by it. So I'm nothing. She said, I'm nothing. I'm just a little girl. I have no status like that whatsoever. I'm the smallest of the small. The smallest of the small. Just a friend who walks beside you. Just a friend who walks beside you. So, you know, that's, you know, the right ultimate way to do it. And Dafri John got mummified. Mummified by it, which is just a reflection of our own desire again to make death permanent, to make impermanence permanent, at least some high aspect of impermanence permanent. It doesn't really work through the continuity problem. It doesn't really didn't do it. You know, there's a projection coming back. He said it was Vivekananda coming back, because Vivekananda was the same way. Before he passed on, he wrote a letter and he said, look, the fact is, everybody, that I am simply a spiritual egotist. My whole life was nothing but spiritual egotism, which is true. When you look at Vivekananda, he was a spiritual egotist. And he was, that complex of delay was pulled back into the world and given the term Dafri John, which he admitted he's the personality form of Vivekananda coming back. And what ended up is turned into stone, turned into a mummy, a sarcophagus. They wanted it mummified. They want truth mummified. So you petrify. He was a petrified guru, petrified into stone. They wanted something in stone, you know, just like he wanted Muktananda's blessing in stone, written. You know, the big conflict of whole life. You know, it's like, did you say I'm the guru, and did you give me say that I'm enlightened? And they wanted that, you know, in stone. They wanted in stone. They wanted enlightenment in stone, ossified, petrified. No, God's lovely, beautiful, living light of remembrance is non-ossified. It is non-petrified. It is not stoned. It is not in stone. It is not stoned. It is not petrified or ossified or mummified in any way whatsoever. Totally unmummified. But then there's no specialness, is there? No, there's no specialness. The vision of oneness, could be said, is the vision of non-specialness. So, you know, the whole lesson of Dhavri Jhana is a terrifying lesson. Terrifying, but ultimately helpful. He says that's what you don't want to have happen. But it's the devotees that's what they wanted. Just like Andrew Cohen recently. You know, he wrote a letter of apology to everybody because he of course, was on a spiritual ego trip. And he's finally realized that. You know, God bless him for you know, realizing it. Better late than never. But he shouldn't have had to apologize. Hey, why is the devotees that they're the ones who empowered him? They're the ones who empowered him. They're the ones that should apologize to him for empowering him and projecting onto him what they wanted. He was what they wanted. Okay? Andrew Cohen is what people, devotees, the projection of our fear, of our continuity fear, that's what they wanted to experience. And he was unable to resist it. Just like Dhavri Jhana was unable to resist the projections of this planet, the world, saying, this is what we want. He couldn't resist it. Vivekananda could not resist it. That matrix couldn't resist it. So that action, that play, that fairy tale, manifested to the devotees who wanted it. So they're the ones who should apologize. They should apologize to Andrew Cohen if they want to be free of it. If they want to be free of the guilt, they're still saying, Andrew, you didn't apologize properly. You're terrible. You're still, you know, egomaniac, blah, blah, blah. No, they're the ones that should apologize to him. Say, I apologize that I projected this fantasy onto you. And it was such a strong projection, you could not resist it. Please forgive me. Please forgive me. That's how the whole thing can. Forgiveness can come into the situation. This is the same thing with Dhavri Jhana. Please forgive me for projecting this onto you. Projecting this. I set you free of this projections. I set you free. You see, and that's how it can. Love can enter into the situation. Forgiveness is the key to at this level where we're at. Forgiveness is the key. So, you know, all these people talking about Andrew Cohen, he didn't apologize enough. That, no, they don't get it yet. They don't get it. They're supposed to apologize to him. That's how forgiveness will come in, because then they get it. You know, the whole thing about these teachers, Dhavri Jhana, Andrew Cohen, you know, those ones that went wrong, you know, to get it, is to forgive them. That then we do get it. And then we say, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, because now I get it. Now I get it. You helped me. You did help me. You were my own projection. You see, you were just a projection of my own, what I thought I needed, and now I see I don't need that. You're free now. And you know what? They'll say, thank God, thank you, because they can't stand it, what they went through. It's a nightmare for them too. It's a nightmare. they're in this dance, and you're setting them free from this dance. You're saying, thank you, I don't need you anymore. Projections, I don't need you anymore. You're free, because, and then they're we're all free to realize there's only one. There's only one vision of non-specialness. Non-specialness of the past, non-specialness of the present, non-specialness of the future. Only one vision of non-specialness, and we are it. We are it. And there's only this. We are it. So, now, I don't know if I'm going to directly say this to these people, these devotees, because maybe they may not be ready for that. So the dance may continue of this non-forgiveness. But you know, I feel compassion for the whole dynamic there, for both sides of the whole thing. It doesn't resolve from having sides to it. It resolves through forgiveness, which is Holy Spirit educates us on what forgiveness really is. And again, it's the devotee's responsibility to forgive the teacher. And saying, you are just a reflection of what I demanded from you, from my fear. And you were unable to say no to that. You know, you're both addicts. You know, two addicts forgiving one another is what has to happen. Forgiveness has to enter the addiction from a higher level, where forgiveness is the vision of non-specialness. When you realize there is a vision of non-specialness that is permanent for you and doesn't change into specialness, then you're in a position to forgive the dualistic dynamic that was happening and born of your fear. You're in a position to do that. You're not in a position of fear or hatred anymore. By the worst devotees I've ever seen are the Daffrey John's devotees. They turn him into a stone. You know, that's heavy, heavy stuff there. They really need to work on forgiveness of the situation. I haven't seen it resolving. I haven't really seen it. It may take a while, but it's fine. That's fine. You know, take as much time as you need. That was a heavy trip. That was a heavy trip. That was an intellectual thing. That was a, you know, Vivekananda, of course, appealed to the super spiritual intellectuals, entitlement class. And that entitlement class said, we're entitled to have the greatest guru of all. And so they got this act, or this projection, this fairy tale of the greatest guru of all. Here he is. Here he is. There's the one that he said, I'm the one you've been waiting for. Of course he's going to say that. I'm the one you've been waiting for. And they said, you're here. Oh, yes, I'm here. And, of course, it was this trip of we are, you know, permanently entitled because we have the one and only guru. No one will ever eclipse this guru. This is the last guru, the only one. This is God. We are entitled. This is our guru. And, you know, that was an entitlement, a spiritual ego entitlement trip, a spiritual entitlement trip. You know, to the ultimate extent, not aware of the continuity problem, not aware of the vision of oneness, not aware of the vision of total non-specialness. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Not aware that the Holy Spirit is the ultimate teacher. The Holy Spirit is the ultimate teacher. There is no other ultimate teacher. Holy Spirit is the grace of God. Okay, there is no guru that is the ultimate guru. Okay, the Holy Spirit is the... Probably should take a break and eat something. What time is it? Yeah. This is very intense. Okay, it's good. thank you for walking beside me. Thank you. Jesus insists that he walks beside us, not ahead of us and not behind us, beside us. So thank you for walking beside me. We're full stopping. We're full stoppers. You can say that. We're full stoppers. That's what really saves us, is see that nobody has any karma. Nobody ever has ever had any karma whatsoever. None. And of course, how could karma get started in the first place? It had to be imaginary. How could anyone in reality accrue karma? It's totally impossible. Totally impossible. So it has to be a dream. It has to be a dream. It has to be imaginary. Therefore, none of us really have it at all. None of us. That's the full stop. If you see there's no karma, that's the full stop, isn't it? It must be. No specialness on anyone. Ah, wonderful. If you see even one special, then you think, oh, reality's not real. Reality's not real. It plays favorites. It plays favorites. And that's a dream too, right? If you think there's something special, it's a dream. If you think there's karma, it's a dream. If you think there's separation, it's a dream. If you think there's parts, it's a dream. So we need to wake up from that dream, vision of non-specialness. I have a non-special, I see a non-special past, I see a non-special present, I see a non-special future. Wow. It's all non-special. I see a non-special, karma-free past, present, and future. That's a full stop in the now. See, now it is the full stop into the past, present, and future. Full stopped in it. Because you realize then it's all just now. It's all the same, so it must all be now. The totality is present, omnipresent. It's now. Now doesn't refer to time. It refers to beyond time. There never was any time that I had karma. There never was any time that I was separate. There never was any time that I was special, or anything was special. There never was a time when anything was special. Not special now, never will be a time when there's anything special. Now is the realization that there isn't any time. There's no such thing as time. In order for time to happen, there has to be change. And truth is changeless. Time is just an assumption. Not today. day I could have gone to a party. I was invited to a big surprise birthday party. And lots of festivities and food and laughter. And very nice people, good people, you know. I'm sure it'd be a very nice atmosphere there. And I said, you know, I got work to do. And I just talked to someone on the phone that was there. And the host invited me. He said, oh, you should come. You should come to the party. I said, thank you so much. But I'm working right here. And they said, oh, I understand, you know. So they understood. I just said, no, I thank you for the invitation. But I've got a lot of work I've got to take care of here. And they said, oh, okay, okay. They're okay with that. So good people. And but look what's been accomplished here today by deciding, make a simple decision, work has to take place here. That's what it's all about. That's what the spiritual path is all about. Do you party or do you work at it? You work. I'm gonna go get something to eat. I could just delay that too, but which would be fine also. But there's no reason to try to make a point of something like, oh, I'm delaying eating or something. No, if you need to eat, you eat. That's fine. Full stop. There's bound to be some nagging concerns that you have. Don't worry about them. Don't focus on them. Don't focus on them. Just focus on the full stop. Just let it sink in. It's kind of like someone gives you like $1 billion, and you say, "Wow, I gotta go put this in my bank account." I mean, look what. And then you start thinking, you know, how am I gonna get the $10 billion more that's coming? When I got all this billion here, I got a real problem here. Now put the billion in your bank account first, and then worry about the next $10 billion that's to come later. You know, it's like that. Let the progress sink in. You know, sure, there's other issues that you can focus on. You're like right away. Don't go there. Say, I'll get to you in a minute or two. Don't. I'll get to that. Don't worry. You got to be firm. Say, I'll get to that. And be honest. Say, honestly, I will get to that. But this, I have to get to this first. So just back off. You know, back off that demand that you answer this question or something. Let me get to this first here. Let me let this sink in. So thank God, thank the Holy Spirit for the opportunity to do this, making it possible to do this. It's an amazing, amazing, amazing situation that I'm able to do this. It's just amazing. I don't even know how it's possible. somehow it's happened. So. It must be that's what I want to happen, so it's happened. I can't really wait. I can't explain time. Explaining how is it possible? It's just the result of, you know, lessening of the fear, lessening of the fear, lessening of the fear. That's the result of that. Being a workaholic, best trait of all. You know, if you're a workaholic, what does anyone need to say to you? You already are you know, working at it. There's nobody who needs to tell you to work at it. You're already doing it. Those are the ones that succeed. Those are the ones that also can make big mistakes. You know, when they're dealing with psychic projection, they take them to be real, then they can work super hard in that direction too. But they also, when they start realizing they made a mistake, they keep working really hard and correct the mistake. So it does, you see, don't be afraid of your workaholic. You think, oh, I may go down the wrong path really too far. Yeah, that may happen. But you'll correct your mistake, and you got the work ethic to put in the work to correct it. And once you've done that, then you really, really have got something, you know. So don't be afraid to make mistakes. You can say, well, I'm working, you know, of course, you may make, you know, you may, probably will, you know, at some point, but you'll work out of it too. When I make a mistake, I say, I think I just made a mistake. Okay, I gotta work to correct this mistake. I don't panic. I say, okay, I know I'll put in the work to correct it. I know it. So I say, okay, no worries, I will correct this. You stay calm, you don't panic. Okay, if it takes, you know, a couple months of intense effort, I will do it. I'll just keep working until it is corrected. I'll get it done. And so you keep steady, like that. So we're not done yet. There's a huge step in the right direction. Huge step here. We're shifting gears, right? We're going into a higher gear now. We're going into higher gear. Got to. The projections in the world are getting very intense. A lot of stuff is going on that we want to shift. Gotta shift gears. Gotta get to full stop. Gotta forgive the whole thing. Full stop, no karma. Full stop, no karma. No karma, full stop. No specialness, no karma. Full stop. Into oneness of now. No karma, no specialness. Full stop into the oneness of now. No karma, no specialness. Full stop into the oneness of now. Okay. Thank you, and thank you, Holy Spirit. That's it for this one.